He may draw you them closer to you. Amen. Can you pick a Seventh-day Adventist out of the crowd? Or would you know them when you walk past them on the street? Maybe not. But there are some distinct characteristics of Adventists all around the world. It all stems from their conviction to reflect the character of God in every aspect of their lives. Not some, but all. Now, growing up, I used to think that Adventists were the most healthiest persons in the world. Now, there are some studies that showed back then that those who lived in Loma Linda were part of this blue crowd, that they lived over 80 plus. They were the healthiest people. There are different areas in the world where people are healthier and they live longer. One of those are Adventists, right? They are some of the most longest living people in the world, or used to be. Now, they found many facets of healthy living, which include the Sabbath, a regular time to rest, recharge, and reconnect. Reconnect with God and reconnect with family and reconnect with yourself. Now, how did we Adventists become so focused on health and well-being? It began early in our history when we began to recognize how personal health can be a powerful expression of faith. We uphold what the Bible says that we should regard our bodies and how we should regard our bodies and our minds. Now, Romans 12, verse 1 to 2 says, I appeal, therefore, brothers, be merciless of God to present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God and what is good and acceptable and perfect. Furthermore, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19 to 20, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. As you can see, there are many benefits to healthy living. More energy prevents diseases, better mood, better sleep, weight loss, improved mental health. You live longer, decreased risk of cancer, better immunity, diabetes control, blood pressure control, cancer reduction. Now I see a lot of cancer what I work with, right? But if we were to take the Adventist health message, the risk would be very much lower. Less cardiovascular disease, less heart attacks, right? Strokes, increased happiness, improved memory. But I say the greatest benefit is that you're able to understand the gospel of Christ and to spread the gospel of Christ. Now, that goes back to all the other benefits. If you have more energy, if you're not sick, if your body is not weary and tired, you'll be able to more understand and accept the Holy Spirit to move in your mind, and therefore you go move to spread the gospel. Because in Mark 16, verse 5, it says, and he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It's difficult to go if you can't move, right? It's difficult to go if you're tired, if you're sleepy, if you can't remember anything. So God gave us this healthy lifestyle, the health message, not so we can be selfish and live longer for ourselves. We live longer for him and for others. That is all the commands, right? So before I end, I would like to talk about the optimum health, which is brought about the new start, right? Nutrition, exercise, water, sunlight, temperance. We all know these as Seventh-day Adventists. Air, rest, trust in God. But this was given to us so we can go, right? It's not to stay. It's not to stay home and be sick. We live this message. We live this message. We live this message. So as I end, I'd like to say thank you for your time, and God bless. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Humes. And we are now ready for our final presentation, which will be brought to us by Dr. Paul Scavallo. But just before he comes, Sister Patrice Clark will bring us her item of music. Thank you.
You don't know the cost. Jesus is willing to accept your alabaster box today. And if you hear his voice, the Bible tells us that we ought to harden not our hearts. Amen? Thank you, Patrice, for that ministry of music today. This morning, I'm going to talk to us about the subject of baptism. Jesus shares not only his words about baptism, but he gave us his example of baptism. Baptism holds a central place in the Bible and in the teachings of Jesus and represents a profound act of spiritual transformation in the hearts of men and women. It is an act that signifies a believer's commitment to follow Jesus Christ and being united with him in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Christendom today has misrepresented the call to represent Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection by putting the emphasis on the fact that he rose on Sunday. But the Bible tells us that we are to celebrate his baptism, his death, and his burial, and his resurrection in two ways. One, by being baptized by immersion, as Jesus did, and he says when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, it also reminds us of Christ's death, his burial, and resurrection on Sunday. So let us begin by exploring the biblical foundation this morning. In Matthew chapter 28 and verse 19, the Bible gives us the instructions of Jesus to his disciples, saying to them, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." Then we see this command, we're reminded that this command symbolizes the essential role of baptism in the Christian's journey. Jesus says, once you believe, then you ought to be what? Baptized. And you know, the good thing about this is that every time that we see people who believe what God is asking them to do, there is no time between, or very little time between, when they believe and when they are what? Baptized. We don't see people saying, well, give me some more time next week, or I'm going to plan it, whatever. We see them going to baptism right away. As a matter of fact, in the experience of the Ethiopian eunuch, when Philip went beside him and he was searching the scriptures and he didn't understand some things, the Holy Spirit drove Philip to him and he went into his chariot, and the Bible says he explained to him the things of Jesus. And as soon as he was finished explaining those things in one Bible study, that Ethiopian eunuch says, well, here is water. What doth hinder me? Amen? And so baptism is that outward expression of an inward desire to do what God asks us to do. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 28, after Peter's powerful sermon on the day of Pentecost, the people were deeply moved and asked, brothers, what shall we do? That is the normal response of somebody who is interested in following Jesus. What must I do? Tell me. And once you are told, because Christ is in you, you are willing to follow what Jesus asked you to do. What did Peter say when this question was asked? He says, repent and do what? Be baptized. Repentance is, as one writer describes it, godly sorrow for sin. Amen? You were doing that which was not right. You say, Lord, I'm sorry. And give me the strength to do what is right. And you know what? God is such a loving and gracious God. He never holds it against you when you were doing wrong and you didn't know any better. All right? He forgives us and he tells us, come and follow me. So repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. And so baptism is an outward expression to say to the world, listen, I am repenting. I am accepting God's forgiveness for my sins. And now by God's power, I'm going to live the life that he has called me to live. And then it says, once this happens, then you shall receive the gift of the Spirit. All right? What is the gift of the Spirit? It's God's Holy Spirit. When Jesus was leaving this earth, he says, I'm going to send to you another one just like me, the Comforter, who will lead you and guide you into all truths. So when you come to Jesus, are you going to know everything yet? No, I don't know everything. And I've been walking with Jesus for over 50 years now. And every day I keep learning more about Jesus. I have some people say to me sometimes, Pastor, I don't know everything yet. You'll never know everything. The path of the just is as a what? Shining light that shines more and more until that perfect day. And even when we get to heaven, there's going to be so much more to learn. You will never know everything. If you knew everything, you'd be God. All right? And so our knowledge is going to increase more and more as we grow with Jesus Christ. And so from these passages and others, we see that baptism is closely connected to repentance, forgiveness of sins, and the indwelling, and this is so important, the indwelling power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Why is that important? Because the Holy Spirit will guide you, empower you, and will teach you more about Jesus. Amen? And that's why I love that hymn, More About Jesus I Would Know. Every day I'm learning more and more about Jesus. So it's important to note that this concept is very explicit in God's Word as you make your decision for Jesus Christ. And let me tell you something. We also see in the Bible that, you know, you don't have to be in a crowd to make a decision. People made the decisions one by one. On the day of Pentecost, we had 3,000. But when it was Philip's time, it was just Philip and Jesus, or rather the Ethiopian eunuch, Philip and Jesus. Amen? So Jesus calls us all individually, one by one. In Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 5, the Apostle Paul encountered some disciples. Some people ask me this question, well, Pastor, I've been baptized before. Do I have to be baptized again? Notice what Paul says in Acts, or rather Luke, in Acts chapter 19, verse 1 to 5, that Paul encountered some disciples in Ephesus who had received John's baptism. That's John the Baptist. You remember when he was preaching out there in the wilderness and Jesus came and John said, behold the Lamb of God. And we heard the evangelist say last night that Jesus asked him to be baptized. And John says, I'm not worthy to baptize you. You need to be baptized in me. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 3, suffer it to be so, so that all righteousness might be fulfilled. Well, what did Jesus mean by that? Jesus wanted to set the right example for all of us. Amen? He wanted to set the right example for all of us. So he, even though he had no sin, went and got baptized. And so as he spoke with them, Paul realized, that is these folk at Ephesus, he realized that they had not yet heard about the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so he asked them, so unto what were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism, which was a baptism of repentance. And the Bible says, well, when Paul explained to them the role and function of the Holy Spirit, is a second time. So there's nothing wrong with having to do a baptism a second time, especially if you did not understand some fundamental truths that God has placed in our lives and in the Word of God for us to follow, like the truth of the Sabbath. You've been hearing all along that it's okay to worship any day. It's okay to worship any day. That's true. But there's only one holy day that God calls us as a people to gather to worship Him on. Amen? We've been worshiping out here every night and having a good time. Isn't that right? But Sunday is not a holy day. Monday is not a holy day. Tuesday is not a holy day. Thursday is not a holy day. Friday is not a holy day. Only Sabbath is a holy day. And we are told that God not only created the Sabbath for us to develop a closer relationship with Him, but He blessed it, He sanctified it, and He set it aside for holy use. Would you say amen? And so, in addition to this, the Bible says not only must we be baptized by water and immerse, and being submerged as Jesus was, and coming up in newness of life. When we are baptized, we are burying the old man of sin. We are doing what? Burying the old man of sin, and then we are rising to a newness of life. Amen. All right? Is there any magic in the water? No. Where does the transformation take place? In your heart. And that's why Jesus says, believe. That's in your mind. And then be baptized. So when the call is made for baptism, and you are hearing Jesus calling you, because it's not the evangelist who's calling you, it is the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, today, if you hear my voice, do what? Harden not your hearts. There are those who have come this morning to be baptized. There are others who might have come not with baptism on their mind. And if God calls you, you are asked to say yes and follow Jesus into the watery grave of baptism. And then you're going to say, Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Will you make mistakes? Yes, you will. Will you slip? Yes, you will. Will you fall? You don't have to. If you do, confess it, come boldly to the throne of grace, where there is mercy and pardon for your sins. Amen? And remember, of all the things He wants us to do, He wants us to abide in Jesus Christ. If you are in Christ and Christ is in you, you will be able to live a victorious life in Jesus Christ. And so today, I encourage each of us to follow Jesus' example, to do as Jesus did, the one and only perfect human being. Amen? And Jesus says, I will keep that which you committed. I want you to turn to Jude verse 24 with me as I conclude today. And I want us to look at it. I'm going to read it for you. And this is a promise that God makes. And this one is especially for those who will make their decision for Jesus Christ. And those of you who have already made your decision, you can renew your covenant with God in this passage today. Jude 24. Notice what it says. Now unto Him, meaning Jesus, that is able to keep you, meaning me, meaning you, Paul, John, Judy, now unto Him that is able to keep you from falling. And then He goes on to present you faultless. Present you how? Faultless before the presence of His glory. And then not only will He present you faultless, He says He's going to do it with exceeding joy. Exceeding joy. There is no greater joy than to see the transforming grace of Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit
working in the life of somebody who gives their heart to Jesus Christ. That's the greatest miracle that we can ever see. There will be miracles formed and taking place here today. And if you hear God's voice saying to you, come, don't resist, follow him. It's Jesus. The devil will say no. Jesus always says yes. Happy Sabbath.
Amen. We want to say thank you to all of our presenters this morning, to everyone who participated in our program. Friendship evangelism is the basis of all successful soul winning. In fact, Ellen White referred to it as Christ's method when she penned the words, Christ's method alone will give true success in reaching the people. The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. He showed his sympathy for them, ministered to their needs, and won their confidence. Then he bade them, follow me. This is found in the Ministry of Healing, page 143. As we close our Sabbath school this morning, let us remember that all of us have a part to play in the success of this Search for Truth gospel campaign. Our friendship evangelism is intentional because friendship evangelism is simple witnessing. If it is done, it is always effective. Mostly unrehearsed. You know, like how if you you find out about a special, a sale, or something going on, you willingly get on the phone and call your friends and tell them, hey, check this out. That's how friendship evangelism is. Some persons may not consider themselves friendly, but I encourage you to give it a try. Ask the Holy Spirit to give you the courage, boldness, and the heart to befriend others in love. Until next Sabbath, may God continue to richly bless you.
Your own dear presence. your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, your hand hath provided. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your
I surrender all to your will, all to your way, God, everything. 'Cause there's nothing between, oh, nothing between, Lord.
Yeah. to the Lord. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Take it to the Lord in
first Sabbath celebration in the Search for Truth Gospel Campaign. Are you excited for today?
Amen.
Oh, amen. Amen. We invite you to stand as we sing our theme song.
Above all kingdoms.
Heavenly Father, King of the universe, we invoke your Holy Spirit in our midst. For you, our God, and you alone is worthy of our praise. We pray, O God, that all hearts are bowed before you will be free and open for you to enter. As we petition the throne of grace and mercy, we seek your word to launch within us, and may we step forward by faith to believe and to do that which is expected. We pray, Father, that you'll anoint afresh the one who have been given this responsibility to speak on your behalf. We pray your word will go forward with power, clarity, and conviction. And all the saints that are here, we say, Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. You know, as I look outside and see what a beautiful day it is, I am just motivated to join with the psalmist and say, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is who? God. It is he that had made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. So therefore today we have entered into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. And so we are thankful unto him. And Lord, we bless your name, because the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. It's such a beautiful day. And God is going to give you a wonderful worship experience here at the Search for Truth Gospel Campaign. Night after night, a man of God has been proclaiming the word. And it's my pleasure to present him to you one more time. He serves as the president of the North Bahamas Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. He serves as the pastor of this, the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist Church, the 8 Mile Rock Seventh-day Adventist Church, and the West End Seventh-day Adventist Church. But God has given him the strength, the conviction, and the power to do what he has called him to do. And so it's my pleasure to present to you the voice of the Search for Truth Gospel Campaign, Evangelist Eric Danny Clark.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. I'm accustomed to saying good evening, everyone. But now we say good morning to everybody. We greet you in the name of Jesus. I trust you had a good night's sleep. I hope you did not have any nightmares, but we have come to worship God in spirit and in truth. Let everything that had breath do what? That's right. We are grateful. We are happy for your presence. We're just happy to be in the house of the Lord. And we have a great lineup for you. I hope you've enjoyed what has been presented thus far. And today, it's no exception. In fact, we've got a very special announcement that we want to give today. And you may have heard us say it on last evening, but we're going to have a baptism today. And we give God thanks for all those persons who have made up their minds to be baptized. Come on, give them a round of applause, please. There's some of them sitting here. There's some in the wings and in the audience generally. We praise God for everybody. We want to say congratulations, all right? And if you're in the audience and you want to be baptized, I'm going to ask you just to touch bases with one of our folk who's standing towards the rear of the church or the front of the church. Touch bases with one of our elders. We'll be able to share with you some of the details of it, because today is going to be a high day in Zion. And whenever a person decides to go all the way with Jesus, it's a high day. Amen? There's rejoicing in heaven, even if it was only one. And we give God thanks and we give him all the praise. So it's a good time. It's a good day to be alive. It's a good day to worship. It's a good day for salvation. Today, salvation has come to some of our families. Amen? And we're so delighted. So I want to take the opportunity to say, you'll hear me say this for the first time, happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. It's a wonderful experience because the Bible gives us to know that this is the seventh day of the Lord. And you know, we've been engaged in the Search for Truth gospel campaign. And we've been searching for truth. There are some people who have been coming out every night and they may not have known where it was found and where it's taken. They hear people talk about the Sabbath. Well, we're going to talk about that tomorrow night. And I want you to bring as many persons as you possibly can, because we're going to present the case for Jesus doing what he did as far as when he worshiped and how he worshiped, all right? So please note, that's for tomorrow evening in the will of the Lord. Today, our subject is the seal of God and the mark of the beast. What is it? We're going to unpack that in a special way, and I hope you are able to stay with us and follow through. We'd also like to say a very special thank you to those persons who are viewing the program online. Every night when I go home, I get a chance to view the program as well. And I'm so grateful for, when I look at it, I see like every night there's 400 and 500 persons that have viewed the program. And I'm so delighted, because it's not just us here. We want to thank God for social media as well. Amen. We want to thank God for social media. And then I want to say a word of encouragement, because some of my team members, they don't get to come out in the night, all right? And so I just want you to know, as team members, that I need to feel your presence in the night. Is that all right? Some of you may be here for the first time. You may have been here last week, Saturday. But I want you to know that we're going every night except Thursday. And we are happy that God has brought us to the kingdom for such a time as this. Amen? So I need your presence. I want to beg you, but I'm offering you my very best and say that together we can accomplish so much more than just one person. Amen? And so I just want to see everybody, by the grace of God, giving him praise and thanks.
thanks as we do what God has called us to do, because what a mighty God we serve. Would you pause in the program and put your hands together and welcome another saint who has decided to follow Jesus all the way, even into the watery graves of baptism? Come on, they ought to be rejoicing in the house of the Lord when there's even one. Right now, we've got four of them here, and there's one or two more that will come, and we're just grateful for where God has brought us. Amen? We're grateful. This is the day. Now is the time. And we say to God be all the glory, great things he has done. Please note then that we're going to be here every night beginning at 7:15 and getting you out by 7:30. I'm sorry, 9 o'clock in the evening. 9 o'clock in the evening, we're going to get you out by 7:15 to 9. And we're just grateful that God has kept us and has used us to his name's honor and glory. We're not going to give out the gifts for today right now, but we will have our questions, and we will have our question man come and share with us some additional information in just a while. But we just want you to know that wherever you're coming from today, and you're here in the sanctuary and you're joining us in the sanctuary, we want to tell you how much we appreciate your presence, and we want to say thank you. So let me ask then, is there anybody coming for the first time? Anybody for the first time? Can I see any hand like that? All right. Got a little hand there or what? No? Okay. Anybody? Yes. We have somebody over this way. Oh, wow. Thank you, man. Thank you so much. Would you guys just make him feel welcome for me, please? Thank you so much. Thank you so much. God bless you. God bless you. Good to have him in the house today. Thank you. All right. And he's alone? You're alone? Oh, okay. Good stuff. That's just, all right. God bless you. And he's come to witness your baptism. Oh, man, I'm so happy for that. That's a special moment. He's come to share with his mom. So God bless you, man. God bless you. All right. So all of my friends who are not the first timers here, but you've been here before, I'm glad you're here. And I praise God for you. Amen. Let's have a great time in the Lord. Let's advance the program. Let's thank God. And before I take my seat, please smile with somebody. Smile with somebody. Come on. Turn around. Look at somebody. Smile. Touch them if you must. Smile with somebody in the front, in the back. Just give them that warm smile. And may God bless you in Jesus' name.
Happy Sabbath again, everyone. Happy Sabbath again, everyone. It is praise and worship time. We invite you to stand as we praise God together. Do you serve a great God? Do you serve a great God?
Oh, yeah.
grateful for the great God that we serve.
Amen.
And if it wasn't for his amazing grace, church, where would we be today? Anybody thankful for the amazing grace of God today? Amen.
Yeah.
today. I don't know how many of you out there are truly grateful to God this morning for his amazing grace. Some of us came in here this morning and we are burdened down. We have been going through all sorts of things. We have some questions that only God has the answers for. And if you fall in that category this morning and you really want to give God thanks for his amazing grace and you want to cast all your cares upon him because you know he's a prayer answering God. He cares for you and he can deliver you this morning. If you need to press to the throne of God this morning and you want him to do something special in your life, I invite you to draw nigh to this altar right now. We're going to have a special prayer this morning for all those who need a special touch from God today. You came here this morning expecting something. God is in the prayer hearing and prayer answering business, and he can do all things but fail. The praise team is going to sing praise God again. And if you are that person who is standing in the need of prayer and that special miracle, Evangelist Abel is going to come and he's going to trouble the throne of God on our behalf. But praise God, church.
Name of Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ, Messiah, wonderful Savior, Prince of Peace, our God and our Savior today, in the precious name of Jesus, we come. We come unworthy though we be. We've been plagued on every side, buffeted. The enemy's job is to destroy and to kill, but you have come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. We see Christ exalted on the cross of Calvary today, and with his stripes, from which flowed blood for my sin, for my iniquity, for my transgression. The promise today is that with your stripes we are healed. Lord, our sin-sick souls yearn after thee. We pant after thee as the deer pants after the brook. We long. Fill us with your word. Fill us with your spirit. Anoint us from the crown of our heads to the sole of our feet today, Lord. May we leave from this place a transformed child of God. As your disciples, Lord, we want to be more engaged in doing your biddings. Help us to be a lighthouse in this dark world of sin, that ships that pass on the ocean of sin might see the lighthouse and find the safe harbor of Jesus Christ. In our transgressed estate, Lord, we say, transform us. Renew a right spirit within us today. It is your Sabbath, and you promise that if we delight to do your will, that you will exalt us Oh Lord, make us more like Jesus. This morning, some of us have come with little sins. And you've promised that you are able to deliver small and great, mighty and weak. No matter what our circumstances are today, we know that we have a delivering Jesus, a God who is filled with all power. Lord, sometimes we think wrong. Sometimes we allow our thoughts to become actions and we act wrong. Sometimes, Lord, we allow the enemy to overwhelm us and we put self before Christ. Oh Lord, help us to exchange our selfish ways for the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on Calvary's cross. Deliver us from ourselves. And then most of all today, Lord, you promised that your presence is here. We ask that you would deliver us into the very presence of the throne room of God. May Christ be exalted. May we see him face to face today. May we behold him, our Jesus and our Lord and our Savior. May we see him there on Calvary's cross, stretched out and suspended between earth and glory for my sin. Oh Lord, if there's any that has come here today feeling that they are unworthy, we are, but Christ has made the provision that we can stand before you boldly today. So may our coming to your altar not be in vain. May we not only sense and feel, but may we leave from here saying that we have seen Jesus. Oh God, we thank you for your promise that you'd never leave us or forsake us. We thank you for your promise that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And if there's one here today who is in doubt, I ask that you would dispel that doubt with complete trust and faith. That we would be willing to walk with Jesus. Thank you for hearing our prayer, and we thank you for the deliverance of from sickness and from our minds that are confused. We thank you for the deliverance from ourselves. We thank you from the deliverance of the enemy and his chains and his shackles. Shake them loose in the name of Jesus today. Let all God's people declare amen and amen. Amen. God bless you. Go rejoicing in the God of your salvation today. Let the church say amen. As we continue the service today, may you have that faith and confidence in knowing that Jesus saves.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Aren't we having a good time out here hearing of God's perfect truth? I'm reminded of the story at the end of the Sabbath school lesson this week. Do some of y'all pay attention to that story? They entitled it The Inside Story. At the end of this week's story, the mother said to her daughter, "You have to trust God always." So I'm going to tell you a little bit about my testimony. Coming up as a young man with a young family and just starting out in the United States, things weren't always good for us. I used to be on welfare. I used to get the government stamps and eat the government cheese. I don't know if some of you all know about any of that. But when you don't have enough, but at least you could tap into something. But I knew what it was to always trust in God. And so the little that we had, we would tithe that up too, and offering that up too. And I'm saying to you, always trust in God. Fast forward about 10, 15 years later, I'm a saver. You heard the financial segment that we get. They said, save some money. I'm a saver. I know what it's like not to have. So save your money. And I did save. But guess what? I was between jobs at one point in my life. You know what between jobs mean? Mean you ain't got no job. Okay? And I remember calling up the mortgage company and saying, hey, this is the last time I'm going to be able to pay you all a full check on my mortgage. I watched the money in my bank account dwindle down to zero. Do you know what happened the next day? I got a call. And somebody said, you got a job. And I said, praise God. I will trust in you always. All I want to say to you today, put your faith in God. Trust in him. It's offering time. Let us pray before we pick up today's offering. Our Father in heaven, we want to thank you for all of your blessings, all of your care, all of your love and your mercy towards us. We ask you, dear God, that as the monies come in, bless those who had to give, those who didn't have to give. We pray, dear God, that you would bless it, that it would go far and wide to do your service. It is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
Once again, for your generosity, God reminds us that it's more blessed to do what? To give than to receive. And we are a giving church here. We give our hearts, we give our lives, and we give our means because God owns everything. Amen? Amen. Well, you know, we hope that you have your cards and your pencils. We're not going to give you a quiz today. Tomorrow night we'll continue the quiz, but you know the evangelist always has something up his sleeve. He might have a question for you at the end of the service today, so please make sure you have your cards and your pencils ready. Now tomorrow evening we're going to start asking some questions. You have been sending a lot of questions in here. Evangelist, somebody even wants to know where did you get your tie from? And maybe they want to give you another tie, and that's okay. He'll receive all the ties you're willing to give him. All right? Somebody wrote a question. These are some of the questions, samples, which he'll be dealing with. What more can we do to prepare for the return of Jesus? All right? And so many other questions that are in here. He's going to deal with some of those questions in his message today. You don't want to turn your air volumes down. You want to listen to everything he's going to be saying today because it's a very vital and important subject. And so please remember, I just love the students out here. You are enjoying these quizzes, and we're going to be right back here tomorrow evening with your quiz for you. So please make sure, if he has a question for you today, to answer those questions. And as you think about it, remember, thy word have I done what? Hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. Right now, the praise team is going to come on and continue to worship with us, and then our evangelist, Pastor President E. D. Clark.
one called to be a witness to some soul who's lost their way. And then to be used as his instrument, so men might see and know. God is faithful to his promise he made a long time ago.
Hallelujah!
tomorrow sure might be too late.
Believe that, and if you want to be ready, put your hands together one more time. Jesus is coming back again. Praise God, He's coming back again. Praise God, He's coming back again. Amen. 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 Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you, praise team. Thank you, everyone. Let me tell you the power of what they just sang. Can I go to the last book in the Bible? Can I go to the last chapter in the Bible? Watch this with me. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 7, the word says, "Behold, I come quickly." That's what they sang about. In verse number 12, it says, "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be." In verse number 17, it says, "And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that hear it say, come." Right? "And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will," that's you and I, "whosoever will, let him take the water of life." How? Freely. And then we go to verse number 20. What is that? 20. Verse number 20, Revelation chapter 22, the last book, the last chapter, verse 20 says, "He which testified these things said, surely I come," how? "Quickly." Amen. "Even so, come Lord Jesus." He is coming back again. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this moment right now. And as we're about to study the word, we thank you that this same Jesus is coming back again. Oh God, while you have gone to prepare a place for us, I pray that you'll prepare us for that place, so that there will be no hindrance, there'll be no distractions, there will be no divided loyalties, that we will all be on one accord, because Jesus is coming back again. Bless the spoken word now, and bless the hearers and the doers. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen and amen. I'm happy for everybody here today. And I give God thanks for all of those who are viewing online. Today for me is kind of a somber message that you just have to give. It talks about the mark of the beast and the seal of God, and there are a lot of people who don't like to go to the book of Revelation because Revelation has these creatures in it. Most times folk don't understand what the symbols mean. And so as a result of that, they stay away from this book of Revelation. But in our search for truth, you've got to cover the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. You've got to know what the Word says and then have a commitment to doing what God says in His Word. So here's the thing that you find sometimes. There are so many people who say when they look at the Word of God, they believe that God doesn't mean what He says. There are so many people who will say that God understands. There are people who will put their faith and their trust in a preacher. They will put their faith and their trust in a church, in a denomination. And they will so often tell you, "Man, I'm doing this because that's what my grandparents did." I want us to search the scriptures today. And that's why I said it's a kind of a somber message, because I want to share with you from the Word of God and from history that there's a deliberate plan that's designed to deceive mankind when it comes to the Word of God. So there are so many individuals who feel that we could do this and do that, you know, on the river and the bank. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, you want to be either in the river or on the bank. But there are some folk who feel that they can do both. All right? And I want you to know that the Bible is very clear. God says what he means, and he means what he says. Amen? With that background, I want to go into the word for today. And I want you to be able to pray and ask God just to speak and allow his Holy Spirit to lead us as we share. The mark of the beast, the mark of the beast, right? And I begin with this passage. Go back to, all right, okay, thank you so much, all right? Revelation chapter 14, there's a couple of verses in there, and I want to crack it open because I want to begin from verse number 7. Verse number 7, I want to begin from this, all right? Verse number 7, it talks, well, verse number 6, Revelation chapter 14, verse number 6, please go there with me. Revelation 14, verse number 6. Let me give you the background to what we have here, and we'll come back to it. There's a couple of angels found in the book of Revelation, angels. Angels are messengers. Are you with me? And in this last prophetic book of the Bible, the angels or the messengers of God were given messages to take to all the ends of the earth. So in verse number 6 now, John the Revelator says, I saw what? Another angel, a messenger, fly where? In the midst of heaven. And what did he have? The everlasting gospel, right? So pause there for a moment. Let's just talk about that. When you talk about the everlasting gospel, what impressions do you get? You get that there's something that will not end. Everlasting, right? You also get the impression that from time immemorial, from the beginning of time to the end of time, and even through eternity, you will still have this everlasting gospel. Are you with me so far? So the Bible says that this messenger fly in the midst of heaven, and he has the everlasting gospel. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world. All right? For a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. You are with me so far? All right. So the everlasting gospel to be preached unto them that dwell in the earth, and it should be preached to every nation, every kindred, every tongue, and every... That's right. So this is the first angel now that flies in the midst of heaven. And this first angel has a message. All right? What is the message? I want to go to verse number 7. What is the message? Look at verse number 7 for me. Verse 7 says, he says, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his what? And then what else should you do? Worship him that made who? The heaven, the earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters. Who is that? That's right. That's right. So this angel, this messenger, says with a loud voice, what should we do? Fear the pastor. Doesn't say the pastor. Doesn't say the church denomination. Doesn't say what I grew up doing. It says fear God. Listen to God. Have a reverential awe for God, because God means what he says, and he says what he means. So the Bible says, fear God, give glory to him, only God. I know there are some churches, and you know, we like to put our pastors up on a pedestal. Man, we believe that the most important committee is the pastor's appreciation committee. I have heard of people who have gone to the bank and borrow money that they didn't have so that they could give it to the pastor. The Bible says we ought to fear God and give glory to him. And then it says what else? We ought to worship him that made what? Heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters, etc. That's only God that made those things. He was the creator God. Am I right about that? Yes, so we have a duty then to fear only God. Now, let's look at this further. I'm sorry, verse number 8 mentions the second angel. And I was here clicking, please forgive me. Verse number 8 mentions the second angel. There followed what? Another angel saying what? Babylon is what? that great city because she made wine of the wrath of her. Now let me just take a moment and share with you. When it says this, another angel flying and saying, it says Babylon is fallen. Who is Babylon? What is Babylon? This here, because it's in a prophetic book, is not only talking about literal Babylon, but it's also talking about spiritual Babylon. All right? So spiritual Babylon is fallen. In other words, Babylon will not rise again. That's why it mentions it twice. It's fallen, and one of the reasons why is because she made all nations do what? Drink of the wine of the wrath of her. Look at that word, fornication. That's it. Fornication is what we call spiritual adultery. See, Jesus says that he is the groom and the church is his bride. And anytime you go against what Jesus tells you to do, you are committing fornication. So you know God says some things. But you say, boy, I always like this. This tastes good. This sounds good. That's where my family is. That's where that is. That, man, I just love that preacher. I love the stained glass. I love the organ. I love this. I love that. The Bible says that that's spiritual adultery, spiritual fornication, because we are to worship God and give glory only to God. That's the second angel. Now let me flip back, if you would, please, upstairs, and let's pick up on our third angel in the slides, right? So Mark of the Beast, verses number 9 and 10. Let's look at the third angel. What does it say, everybody? Can we read it together? Then, saying, if anyone and is, and do what? Or in his, let's go on. Sorry, he himself also shall of the wine of the wrath of God, which is full strength into the cup of his. All right, so this is important here now. And the rest of it, verse number 10 says, he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. It'll make sense in just a moment or two. What you've got to understand is that anything against God is fornication and adultery. That's the spiritual expression for it, right? And so what we just read, we'll unpack in a moment, but here's the correlating passage in Revelation chapter 13, and I'm going to read a number of passages in chapter 13. Verse number 18 says, here is what, everybody? Here is wisdom. Let him that has understanding, what should we do? Calculate what? The number of the? For it is the number of a, and his number is what? Have you ever heard that before? All right. Let's tie it all in. I'm suggesting to the church today that when you look at the word of God, being loyal to God invites what? It does. It invites persecution, but it pays eternally. Can I give you my own family experience? My mom was married when she discovered certain things from the word of God. And her and her husband decided they're going to follow God and worship on the day and time when God, Jesus, worshiped. She had 7 sisters and 1 brother. And the majority of them died. And they did not forgive her for following what thus saith the Lord. My grandfather was a first day preacher. Built a church. And he said, this coming Sunday, we're going to have the biggest service that this community has ever had. And I never met my grandfather. But that Sunday, they had the biggest service. And it was his funeral service. Being loyal to God invites persecution.
but it pays eternally. That means that no matter what the enemy tries to throw at you, God will come through for you and he'll reward you in the final analysis. Can you say amen? Amen. Thank you so much. That's it. Thank you. I'm getting it now. So what is the mark? We're talking about the mark of the beast. What is the mark, right? Mark one is disloyalty, all right? Because mark is used in opposition to the seal. So on one hand, you have the mark, and on the other hand, you have what? The seal. So when you talk about a mark, you're talking about disloyalty in the Bible. When you talk about the seal, you're talking about loyalty, and loyalty is to whom? That's right. So the mark has to do with a number, and it has to do with a name, and it has to do with a man. Did we read that in the Bible?
Yes.
All right, and that number is what? That's right. It says 66. That's the number, right? And so we find a person, and I want to give you this little background here. There's a person by the name of Constantine in history. Have you ever heard that name? Constantine, in 350 AD, he gave to the Roman church, he gave to the papacy, I should say, Rome, whole country, right? He donated Rome to the bishop. So what they had at that time was what was called pagan Rome. And Constantine made a donation of Rome as a place, as a country, to the bishop. And what it became known as afterward was papal Rome. So pagan Rome, from Constantine to the leadership of the church, became papal Rome. What else do you find? Constantine, when he left Rome, he gave his seat to the pontiff. Do you know who the pontiff is? That's the Pope. He gave his seat. So when he was leaving, he gave his seat. And the Bible tells us that this power is a different power. It's a universal system. And the third characteristic, not only is it different and universal, but I want to share with you what the third characteristic is. And in verses number 5 and verse number 6 of the book of Revelation chapter 13, would you read with me on the screen, please? And there... And he opened his mouth against whom? To do what? Blaspheme his name. Now that's what the pontiff did. All right? That's what the Bible says. And I want to share with you that there was a time when they accused Jesus of blasphemy. All right? They accused Jesus in John chapter 10. What verse? 33. The Jews answered. Would you read? The Jews answered him saying what? For a good work, we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, and because you, being a man, make yourself. Understand what's happening there. I want to relate to your minds this morning for a little bit. They said that they are going to kill Jesus because Jesus was blasphemous. What was the blasphemy? He said he was God. Now I just shared with you, and I'll share it with you again, that the pontiff also declares that he is God. He claims the privileges of God. And the question is, does anybody try to stone him? But we'd want to try and stone Jesus. Yeah? So he claims the privileges. I went into the Ecclesiastical Dictionary, and here's what I found. And there's a couple of verses, and it really shook me up when I read this. It says what, everybody? Would you read with me? The Pope, and so that he is not a, but as it were, the what? Vicar or vicar of God. Please receive that. This is not my words. This is not the church that I go through to. This is what the pontiff, this is what the Roman church puts out there. This is from their encyclical dictionary. The Pope is of so great dignity and he is so exalted that he is not a mere man. I agree with you.
Let's go further. That's why I said it's so somber and sober today. He is likewise, come on, read it with me. He is likewise the divine monarch, one, what else? Supreme emperor, what else? And king of kings, so that it be possible that the angels heir the faith, I want to get you this, they could be judged and excommunicated by the Pope. Give it to you again. This is the Roman Catholic Ecclesiastical. He is likewise the divine monarch. Divine monarch. He is the supreme emperor and the king of kings, so that if it were possible that the angels, erred in the faith, right? They're saying that they could be judged and excommunicated by the Pope. So he is higher than the angels. He could judge the angels. So what I'm trying to say to you now is, when you see what God's word says, right? And you see what the church has tried to do, and then when we try to follow what the church has tried to do, believing that we're sincere, not realizing that we are sincerely wrong if we are outside of the word of God. You could smile all the way to your doom, your death, your destruction. I go further, page number 304. Look at what it says in this same, the encyclical letters of Leo the 13th, I think that is, Leo the 13th, page 304. He says, we hold upon this earth the places of God Almighty. And he was a pope. Leo the 13th was the pope. He says, we hold on this earth the place of God Almighty. Now you tell me if that ain't sin. He has the privilege, blasphemy. He has the privilege. They have the privileges of God. They have the ability to forgive sins, they say. They say, seek where, this is page 78 and 79, the Catholic priest, seek where you will through heaven and earth, and you will find but one created being who can forgive the sinner. Are you ready for this? It says, seek where you will in heaven and in earth. You will have one created being who can forgive the sins and the sinner. Let's look at who it is. That extraordinary being, come on, is who? Is the priest, the Catholic priest. So when you talk about going for confessional, when the Bible already tells us that there's one mediator between God and man, and that's who? The man Christ Jesus. That's important. This is what we teach. This is what they teach. And then sometimes we have to pay them to teach us these things. So we go and support their schools, and they make sure that you learn how to do all the Hail Marys and everything else. I looked further in a book called Dignity and Duties of the Priest, and you can find all of this online. All of it online. Volume 12, page 2. Look at what it says. Read it with me. God himself is obliged to abide by the judgment of his priests. And what else? And either not to pardon or pardon according as they refuse or give absolution. What that is saying is that God has to listen to the priests. That's what they mean when they say God is obliged to abide by the judgment of his priests. And either to pardon, whether priests make a decision to pardon or not, according as they refuse or give absolution. And it says the sentence of the priest, come on now, the sentence of the priest precedes. What does that word mean? It goes before, precede, and God subscribes to it. That means that whatever the priest says, it comes first. And God has to agree with what the priest says. You see why I felt a way today? I want to be excited. I want to be happy. I want you to shout and jump and all the rest of it. But I needed you to get the word. We need no priest after Jesus. Amen. We don't need it. Because Jesus is who? Our high priest. So 1 John 1:9 says, if we can what? Confess our sins. He is what, everybody? He is faithful and just to do what? Forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from?
Lord.
Cleanse us from?
Lord.
And yet, every Sunday, there are folk who will go and say, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. You go to a man to confess your sins. Word says, if we confess our sins to God, it is He who is faithful. It is He who is just. He who is the one who can forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from how many? All unrighteousness. It was granted to him, Revelation chapter 13, verse number 7, talking about the beast power. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. So I want you to note that when you compare Bible with history, it backs it up. History supports what the Bible says. It says there's a power that will have power and they will overcome the saints. And that happened. There was a period called the Dark Ages, 1260 years, 42 months in the Bible. Not a new invention was created during that time. The Bible was hid from the people. It was chained to the pulpit so that the common people could not read the Bible. And they had to hear what the priest said to them about the Bible. That tradition continues so that today people are still going to man for direction on what the Word of God says. As a result of that, there were more than 50 million people that the Roman church killed because they wanted the Bible and the Bible alone. A couple of years ago, they did an interview with the Pope, and the Pope said they were considering apologizing. 50 million people. This is history. This is no fable. You can Google it now as I'm talking to you. The Roman church killed more than 50 million people because those folk were standing up for the right. They were standing up for the word of God. They were standing up for truth. And what happened? They lost their lives. The Bible says he was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be what? Killed. That's right. He caused all, small, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads. And you're going to discover that the mark is not a literal mark, but it's an ability. And that no one may be able to what? Buy or sell, except who? The one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Now, I want to ask you to give me a few minutes. Let's try and look at this. You are not able to do what, everybody? Buy or sell what? Anything, okay? And here is the patience of the saints now. Here's where you get the clarification for all of it. Revelation chapter 14, verse number 12. Here's the patience of the saints. There are they what? Keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. It's interesting that saints are not saints when they've been dead for 100 years and then they come up with a story about them. Saints are not saints when the church votes you as a saint. The Bible says, and your Bible says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they who do what? Keep God's commandment and have what? The faith of Jesus. Those are the two characteristics of a saint.
So the question is, am I keeping God's commandments? Do I have the same faith that Jesus had? And that will answer it for us.
So in Revelation chapter 7, verses 2 and 3, it says, then I saw this other angel ascending from the east, having the seal of God. I've shifted now, having the seal of God, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to do what? To harm the earth and the sea, saying, do not harm the earth and the sea. Why? Or the trees, until we have done what? Seal the servants of our God. Where? We're going to explain it. When you talk about a seal, you want to appreciate that a seal has three characteristics. What are those? One, the name. Two, title. And what's the third one? Territory. Every seal has that. My lady here is the justice of the peace. She has a seal, and the seal has those three things. What's her name? What's her title? And what's the territory, right? So between these two things now, there's the seal and there's the sign. There's the mark, I should say, and then there's the seal. That's the two signs, okay? And you have now very clearly that the seal, for example, of the President of the United States is that the seal, the title is what? President. The territory is the United States, and whatever his name is, that's what would go there, all right? I have a seal also, and many of you here have a seal, and those are the three characteristics. Now, God's seal is complete. And God's seal is found in Exodus chapter 20 and verses 8 to 11. Would you read it with me? It says what? Remember the Sabbath day to do what? Keep it holy. 6 days you shall and do how much? All your work. But the seventh day is the what? Sabbath of the Lord your God. It says, for in 6 days the Lord made what, everybody? The heavens and the earth and what else? The sea and all that in them is. And then what did God do? He rested on T-H-E. What's that? The or the seventh day. It didn't say he rested on a seventh day, but he rested on the seventh day. How many seventh days do you have in a week? Just one. The seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Can I ask you to note that God did not bless any other day but one? Just one day? Just one day. You could worship on any day that you want to worship on. That's your business. But you can't worship on any day and still be doing the will of God. You could go to church on any day you want to. But going to church on a day doesn't make that a blessed day. It doesn't make that a hallowed day. It doesn't make it a Sabbath day. In fact, the enemy is laughing all the way to the bank at you. Because the Bible says there is a way that seemeth right unto a person. But if you're not careful, the end thereof are the ways of death. So we said the seal of God had the name. What else? The title and the territory. In the Sabbath commandment, it has God's name. It has his title. And it has that he is, his territory is heaven and in earth. Now, do we live in the territory of God? Do we live in heaven and earth? Yeah. So that means that God's seal should cover all of us. Am I right about that? God's seal should cover us. Not only should God's seal cover us, he says in the book of Isaiah chapter 66, he says not only for heaven and earth, he says, but when we get to heaven, the seal still remains. He says, and from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord. That's Bible. I give you Bible. Ezekiel 20 and verse number 20. Let's read it together. What does it say? Hollow am I that they be a what? Sign between me and you that you may know that I am the Lord your Lord. So what is the significance of the Sabbath? He says it's a sign between me and you. That you may know that I am your God.
Now, if you keep another day, what's that saying? That's it. You're outside of the sign. Amen? So I go to a conclusion now because our time is going through, right? But watch this. Sunday, and I go to the Catholic record for this. Where do I go for this? The Catholic record. What date? September 1, 1923. Would you read it with me? Sunday is our mark of... Who is writing? The Catholic record. Sunday is our what? Mark of authority. The church is above the what? And its transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact. Do you understand what's happening there? The Catholic record says that if they have any authority, Sunday is their mark of authority. And they said that as a church, they're above the Bible. And they have transferred now the sanctity and the sacredness of Sabbath to Sunday. And that's the proof that they're above the Bible and that they are the supreme authority. And do you know what happens? All the world wondered after this power. So those who worship on the first day of the week think they're worshiping because of the resurrection. God says if you want to honor the resurrection, you want to keep the Sabbath. You want to be baptized. He says, man, you don't try and change what I have put there and call that a new law or whatever it is. He says, they said, their proof is that they have transferred the sanctity of the Sabbath over to the first day of the week. Now watch this. Every other person, every other religious denomination basically worship on which day of the week? That's right. And if the Catholic Church says they have the authority to do that, and they say the example that they have the authority to do that is because everybody else following them. Question, are you following them? Here's what else they said. They said, by my divine power, this is Father Enright, all right? He says, by my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep holy the first day of the week. Can I ask you, which man can abolish God's law? Here's him continuing now. And lo, it's like, let me get your attention here. All right? And lo, the entire civilized world bows down in reverent obedience to the command of the Holy Catholic Church. We bow down in reverent obedience. In opposition to what God says. God says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The Roman church says, man, forget what God says. We're going to institute the first day of the week. And all the rest of the denominations, they follow that. That's why the Bible says, you know, not all Israel is Israel. Not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into the kingdom. But we've reached a place where every person must do what? Choose for themselves. But there is good news, amen? And we always leave on good news. Revelation chapter 15 and verse number 2. And I saw something like the sea of glass mingled with what, everybody? With fire. And those who have the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. Hallelujah! There will be those who will stand for the right, though the heavens fall. They will be his true followers. They will say, take the world, but just give me Jesus. They will say, I see what man says, but I want to do what God says.
They will say that I know my mother did this and my father and my grandmother and my grandfather. Even my husband or my wife. But the truth is that you have to answer for yourself. Amen. So I've shared this with you today. And it rested heavy on my heart. And it's not that I'm tired, but I realize that some people may not have known it. And some people are deliberately being deceived. There are some pastors and preachers who know what the truth is. And they're not going to tell you. One of the reasons why they're not going to tell you is because they love your money. That's why from night one, I said to this congregation, I said, man, listen, we appreciate your offering, but even if you don't have a dime to give, still come. Because this ain't about money. This is about Jesus. This is about soul salvation. This is about heaven or hell. This is Jesus saying, I have gone to the cross to set an example for you. And he says, what are you going to do with the sacrifice that he made? When they put that crown of thorn on his head and twisted it when they got it on his head. What you going to do about Jesus? And then you have the heart to say he understands. When he went all the way to Calvary for you and for me. And that's why today, I'm not asking the folk to sign a card or anything like that. But I want to ask if you would be bold enough to say, I am receiving Jesus today. I want to follow Jesus. I want to go where Jesus leads me. I want to say anywhere with Jesus, I can safely go. Would you stand with me if that's your commitment today? Would you stand with me? Would you stand with me all across the church? All across the church, would you stand with me? All the way my Savior leads me. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercies, who through life has been my guide? Now that you're standing, in an attitude of prayer, I want to ask if there's somebody who will make a commitment today to give their lives to Jesus and even say all the way, even into baptism, I want to follow Jesus. If there's somebody here, I want to ask you to walk out of your seat. Come like a champion. Come like a servant of the Most High. Come like an overcomer. Come like a victor and say, give me Jesus. If there's one while we sing today, all the way my Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercies, who through life has been my guide? Would you come, please, wherever you're coming from? I know it's a difficult thing, but you could still come. You can still come. I thank God for these persons who are already dressed for the baptism, but I believe there's somebody else in the congregation today. There's somebody else in the congregation today. You may not have asked anybody for permission. You may not have come prepared for this decision. You may not have checked with husband or wife, father or mother, or even children or parents. But today is just you and Jesus. Just as I am without one plea. But that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Would you come? Would you come? Jesus went all the way to Calvary just for you. What can you do for him? What can you do for him? Come on. I want to thank God for somebody today. I want to thank God for somebody today. I want to thank God for somebody today. God bless you, my friend. I saw you there. God bless you, my friend. God bless you. Thank you, young man. And my
for me. Stand with him for me, please. Stand with him for me. Your boy wants to make this decision. We have clothing for him also. God bless you. Put your hands together for a mother who will allow her son to be baptized today. Those of joy I see. Come on, all the way, one more time. And if there's somebody else, I'm doing this for the last time. All the way my Savior leads me. Come on. For the joy of his love. Perfect rest to me is promised. Come on, in my Father's house above. Is there somebody else? I just want to hold the doors open for just a moment longer. If you need somebody to walk with you, we'll walk with you. This is my song of endless ages. Jesus leads me. So much, beloved. God bless you. Thank you so much. God bless you. Put your hands together. I give God thanks. There's my daughter coming up. God bless you. Oh man, Pastor Paul, this is a day of rejoicing. Thank you so much. God bless you. Oh boy, I missed her 17th birthday a couple of days ago, and I asked her to please forgive me. And she said, I forgive you. So I said, I'll make it up to you, and I will baptize you personally.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. This is Nina's baby. God bless you. Is there one more who would just join us today? Pastor Paul is ready just to do what we call an examination of the candidates. He shares a vow with us because we make a commitment to Jesus. We make a commitment. Come on, this is the Grammy coming up here. We rejoice with her. Sister Edna, thank you so much. God bless you. Is there one more who would come, please? One more who would come? Before I turn the program over to Pastor Paul, is there one who would come? Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, you see every burdened soul here today. You see every decision that needs to be made. Oh God, we thank you that Jesus went all the way to Calvary so that we can have life and have it more abundantly. And today there may be somebody who did not come prepared, who may not have told anybody, but the Spirit is speaking to them. Father God, it's a decision that they will never regret. Because when you cast all on the altar of sacrifice, when you give it to Jesus, Jesus guarantees your success. He will take care of you. He will fix situations. He will meet your needs. He will work things out. So that when you go all the way into the watery graves of baptism, you will rise to walk in newness of life. So God, touch another heart now. Touch another heart. You don't force anybody, but you said you love. You love, you love. And I just want to pray, oh God, that we will experience that love of Jesus right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for your tremendous sacrifice. Please put your hands together as one more response to the altar. Thank you, Brother Benjamin. Thank you so much, sir. God bless you. Jesus was waiting on him. I believe he's waiting on somebody else also. I believe he's waiting on somebody else. Have your way, Lord. Have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. Pastor Paul, please take this and have the examination of the candidates. I'd be happy to go and change, prepare for the baptism. Yes.
We're going to ask you 13 simple questions, and I'm going to use the child's version. We have some of our children here with us who are going to be baptized. I want to invite you to come a little closer. And each question, I'm going to ask you just to raise your right hand as a confession of faith in Jesus Christ today. I just need you to raise your right hand at each question, all right? Question number one. Do you believe in God the Father, in His Son Jesus Christ, and in the Holy Spirit? Amen. Amen. Do you accept the death of Jesus to pay for all of your sins? Number three, do you accept the new heart that Jesus gives to you in place of your sinful heart? Amen. Number four, do you believe that Jesus is in heaven as your best friend and that He gives you His Holy Spirit so that you can live a victorious life? Do you believe God gave you the Bible as the most important book and guide for your life? Number six, by God living in you, do you want to obey His Ten Commandments, which include the observance of the seventh day of the week as the Sabbath of the Lord? Number seven, do you want to help as many people as possible to be ready for His soon coming? Number nine, is it your desire to help God's church with your influence, your effort, and the monies that He would give to you? Number 10, do you want to take good care of your body because your body is the Holy Spirit's temple in which He lives? Number 11, with God's power, would you determine today to obey the basic principles of the Bible as taught by the Adventist Church and as God reveals more of them to your life? Number 12, is it your desire to be baptized today as a witness to the world and to declare that you are a follower of Jesus Christ? Amen. And the last question, is it your desire to become a member of this Seventh-day Adventist Church, this local branch, and believe that this church has a special message to give to the world? Amen. Amen. You have seen the affirmation of faith of these candidates. Today, is there a motion that they be accepted in the church fellowship subject to their baptism? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no, it's carried. Amen. God bless you as you have come. Those of you who have not yet been changed, the ushers will help you to become prepared. Those of you who have not yet given us your information, please sign those cards before you go. The ushers will assist you in preparation while Pastor Clark gets ready to go in the pool. We can sing a few hymns and songs or praise and worship as you prepare them for baptism at this time. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Beloved brothers and sisters, we give God thanks for Chet Price in the waters today. Amen. And Chet has decided that he wants to follow Jesus all the way. And so Chet, because you love Jesus and because you want to follow Jesus' example, I baptize you in the name of Jesus by the authority of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. And let all the people say,
Amen.
Squeeze me tight.
Three, 3, 6. There's a fountain filled with blood.
Congratulations.
3, 3, 6.
All this. Brothers and sisters, we rejoice with Sister Jayla Martin in the waters today. And we say to God be all the glory, great things he has done. And we're just so happy for Jayla. Jayla, because you love Jesus more than anything else in the world, and because you want to be saved when Jesus Christ comes, I baptize you in the precious name of Jesus by the authority of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. And let the people rejoicing together say,
take a deep breath.
And sisters, Sister Yvette Bain has decided that this day will not pass her by. She has seen me outside of this church environment. She says, Pastor, guess what? I'm going to join the church. I'm going to join Jesus, and I'm going to be baptized. And so, Sister Yvette Bain, because you love Jesus and because you've decided that you want to follow his example, as a minister of the gospel, it gives me the greatest joy to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And let all the people say,
take a deep breath for me.
Beloved brothers and sisters, Sister Demetria Russell has decided that she wants to be baptized, and this is her day.
Oh man, I want to rejoice, and maybe I should have done it with all the rest of the family, but can I ask those who are connected to Demetria, would you just stand please so that we can acknowledge you? All right, thank you so much. Put your hands together for them. All right, thank you so much. I'm looking for a son. Where's a son? I need him to come close. I need the son to come close, and then I need the two of you come, please. Two of you come. All right. Oh man, the two of you come. I need you all to observe this because I want your son to follow you, ma'am, in short order, okay? All right, God bless you. The other gentleman is coming because I always tease her, I'd always call her a certain name. But God is good, isn't that so? Demetria, because you love the Lord Jesus, and in the presence of these witnesses, and because there's rejoicing in heaven, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Squeeze me tightly. All right. Beloved brothers and sisters, in the waters, Sister Lanisha Wims. And for those of you who may not know, I need to say this right here. This is Marsha's niece. Many of you, Marsha, huh? Yes, Marsha McPhee. Marsha McPhee, and she's just been a blessing to this church. And Lanisha said that when she saw the change in Marsha, she wanted to be associated with the church that Marsha was associated with. Next week in the will of the Lord, we will pray for Lanisha's children and we cover them in the name of Jesus. But today, it's Lanisha's decision. And I want to thank God for the one who worked with her, Sister Allison, who is here also, and all of the rest of the persons who have been praying. And so, Lanisha, because you love the Lord Jesus, and upon the profession of your faith in the Lord Jesus, as a minister of the gospel, I now baptize you in the precious, powerful name of Jesus by the authority of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And let all the people say,
amen. Take a deep breath for me. Hold me tight.
Beloved brothers and sisters,
Today, Pastor Paul, Sister Nina, and I, and her Grammy, Sister Edna Stubbs, along with all the family, are rejoicing with Sister Giselle Humes today. We want to celebrate Giselle's birthday as well. She has just turned 17 years old, and we are so happy that this day has come. And so, Giselle, the water might be a little chilly, but your heart is warm and heaven is glad. And Jesus went all the way to Calvary just for you. Amen? And so upon the profession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you in the powerful name of Jesus by the authority of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And let all the people say,
amen. Take a deep breath.
Herein I know the sweetest song I sing, I pause to sing. When this holistic sounding tongue is ransomed from the grave, is ransomed from the grave, is ransomed from the grave.
$294, power in the blood.
What you can do is bend your legs as well, okay?
But brothers and sisters, Brother Godfrey Lang is in the waters today.
Amen.
And we are rejoicing with Brother Godfrey.
Amen.
Godfrey, God has been good to you.
Amen.
He's brought you from a mighty long way.
Yes, sir.
And you have decided to go all the way with him, even in the watery graves of baptism.
Amen.
And because you love the Lord Jesus, and because you want to follow Jesus and go to heaven with him,
yes,
it gives me the greatest pleasure to baptize you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
By the authority of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And let all the people say,
amen.
Take a deep breath.
Would you be free from your burdens? There is power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you, O evil, a victory ring? There is wonderful power in the blood. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. Oh,
it is.
Beloved brothers and sisters, we want to rejoice with Sister Nika Black today. Nika has been here and she just loves it, and God loves her and we love her. Amen. And Nika, because you love the Lord Jesus, we just want to thank God for his goodness, his blessings in your life, in our lives. And we believe that today is going to be the beginning of a wonderful experience with you and Jesus. All right? And so, because you love the Lord Jesus, we now baptize you in the name of Jesus by the authority of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. And let the church rejoicing together with Nika Black say,
amen.
Would you be free from your passion and from every power in the blood? Power in the blood. Come for a cleansing from Calvary's hand. There is wonderful power in the blood. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. Of the blood. Oh, there is
listeth, and no man knows.
Yes.
Brother Rudy Stubbs is sitting in the back, and he's requested to be baptized.
Amen.
Amen.
So I need the deacons to assist me with him. He has to be lifted into the pool and lifted out. So I need all the strong arms.
Yes, yes. Amen.
All right, so it's going to take a moment or two for this to take place. All right, and help him in this moment. Jesus died for everyone. Amen. My good friend, Brother Rudy Stubbs. All right. We thank God for the faithfulness of his wife, who's here with us.
Eh?
Yes. Brother Rudy, I'm going to give you the short version. There are three questions. You've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior a long time ago. And today you want to fully surrender to him. Is this your desire? Amen. As you accept the death and burial and the resurrection of Christ in your heart today, is it your desire to become a part of God's remnant church that keep his commandments? Amen. Are you willing to be baptized in this pool today? Amen. You say in the affirmation of faith in the church, is there a motion in this regard that he be accepted in the church fellowship subject to his baptism? Is there a motion? It's moved. Is there a second? Seconded. All in favor, please say aye. Father God, we thank you for the work of your Holy Spirit here today. Again, continue to inspire our hearts. Our hearts rejoice with Rudy. Lord, keep him in all his ways. May he acknowledge you. Bless him now as he goes into this watery grave of baptism. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen. Okay, just help him to the side there, and then we'll lift him in the pool.
Would you do service for Jesus, your
yes.
King?
Yes.
There
yeah.
is power in the blood. Power
yeah.
in the blood. Yeah. Would you lift him his praises to sing? There is wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood.
Excuse me. Beloved brothers and sisters, we rejoice today in the God of our salvation. This day, salvation has come to this home in a special way. We have Brother Rudy Stubbs, who has decided that he wants to make this commitment to follow Jesus all the way. And so, Brother Rudy, because you have given all to Jesus, because this day signals a new day in your life, as ministers of the gospel, we now baptize you in the powerful, mighty name of Jesus by the authority of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And the church will rejoice and heaven will rejoice with you together. And let all the people say, amen, amen and amen. Going back. Amen. God bless you. God bless you in Jesus' name, man. Yes, sir. To God be all the glory. Amen. Great things he has done. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we thank God. I'm going to ask Pastor Paul just to offer the benediction as we close today. We're going to be able to greet these saints in the name of Jesus. Would you give us a round of applause to all who have been baptized? We give.
Let us pray
for the nine persons.
Let us stand.
Okay. Yes.
Father, we thank you today for Jesus. And for the disciples that have been born into the kingdom, help them now to put their complete trust in you. And may they tell somebody else and bring them to the meetings this week so that we might see another rich harvest of souls. Thank you for the message and for the messenger. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus.
Yes.
And bless the fellowship and the meals that should go on and bring us back tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 And amen.
Amen. Thank you all. God bless you. There is a fellowship meal provided for everyone today. God bless you. For the deacon, Hoppy.
And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. I'm Evangelist Eric D. Clark, and I've been given the wonderful responsibility to lead out in what is coming right around the corner. It's called the Search for Truth Gospel Campaign. Can I tell you the dates for this series of meetings begin on April 7th? Yes, that's Sunday evening, April 7th, beginning at 7:15 in the evening. And I'd like to give you a very special invitation to attend. In fact, I'd like to invite you and your family to be a part of this wonderful Bible seminar that we're going to have. Can I tell you, we're going to have 2 weeks of meetings. The off night is going to be Thursday night and Saturday night. But apart from that, we're going to be at the Freeport Church on the corner of Beachway and Gambier Drive every night beginning at 7:15. We know your time is important. We cherish your time. And we want you to know that we are packing so much into this just so that your blessing will come from Almighty God. Every night, we're going to have the power of the preached word. We're going to have good soul-stirring, sweet gospel music. We're going to have the power of prayer because we know that prayer changes things. And then, of course, we're going to have quizzes and questions, and there's going to be health features. Hey, the wealth of the nation is really the health of the nation. And so we are making a special effort to make sure that you are healthy, wealthy, and wise. We want to thank you, and I want you to receive this as my personal invitation to you and to your family. Remember, it's April 7th. That's Sunday. It's a 7:15 that we begin. We guarantee to get you out before 9 o'clock. And in the will of God, let's come and study the Word of God together. Let's grow so that we can demonstrate that we are God's children by our love. Until then, may God bless you and hold you. And I'm looking forward to seeing you in that time.